let's start our. You always get that a few seconds of uncertainty when this thing is loading up. How are we doing on the lectures? Anybody is using this? How many of you have it work properly? Like it's updating like a normal notebook, like it should? Nobody? I remember some of you got it to work. Okay, well, okay, so we reviewed essentially what we did last time at the end of the lecture was to use simple Fourier properties to solve the wave equation, right? So come on.
Something touching the screen.
What?
Is something else touching the screen?
Oh, maybe this button was. You're right. The volume button was changed. Okay. Thank you. I was going to restart it. When in doubt, you restart. Okay. So we used the Fourier properties that we did in the previous two lectures to really solve the wave equation. And the 1D wave propagation gives us a solution in the form of a plane wave. We all knew that, but I think it's important to keep this in mind. This is the way to solve the wave equation in the fastest possible way. The 3D, if your source is a delta function, you solve this immediately in the frequency domain, bring it back to the spatial domain, and you get your spherical wave. And it's important that when you do that Fourier transform back, you use that sync as the kernel. Remember, with the spherical symmetry, 3D Fourier transform somehow becomes a 1D integral with the simple kernel in the form of a sync of KR. OK, so basically, if I have a certain source, which could be 3D, the final solution of the field coming out of that source, so imagine this is a domain that somehow emits light, so it's a fluorescent cell or blob. If you want to compute what happens to the field outside that source, you need to perform this integral. Why? Because as a linear system, we know that the output of that system, right, is the convolution between the input and the impulse response. And we just calculated last time that the impulse response of free space is a spherical wave. So basically, the field everywhere will be the source convolved, and this is the way the convolution is done, in 3D. So what you notice right away is that it's not very friendly in general, that integral, right? So this is the full solution, but in terms of getting something analytic out of it, it's very difficult unless you look at very simple problems. So we're going to look at approximations of that equation. And the approximations are done in terms of basically how close we are to that source. So meaning that if this is your source and my observation plane is at a certain distance z, Notice, as you come very close to the source, the field has very, very high structure. So imagine you come close to the surface of that lamp. What you're going to see is very high frequency fluctuations, meaning from point to point, the fields could be very, very different. Okay? So it's a lot of information there, very high frequency information, right? Short spatial scales. But as we go farther and farther away from the source, what does that convolution integral tell us? This integral. What does that do to my field? You told me last time, when I do a convolution, what does that do to your signal in general?
It should smooth it out.
Will smooth it out. That's exactly right. Meaning, the farther you go from the source, the field will look smoother and smoother. The farther you go, the smoother it gets. It's kind of like, I use this analogy, if you have a very wrinkly shirt, as you go farther and farther away, it's as if you blow it up, you stretch it, it becomes smoother and smoother. Okay? So it turns out that this kind of keeping that in mind helps us approximate the propagation into, you know, bring it to simpler and simpler forms. So Fresnel came up with this approximation that basically takes the spherical wave e to the ikr over r, and basically what he does is, so if you have e to the ikr over r, you can approximate it. First of all, you can replace this by z, meaning that if I'm far away from the source, whether I'm here measuring this distance r, magnitude of that, let's say, or this distance z, they're kind of the same. I mean, they're not perfect, but pretty much the same, right? The difference is a cosine, and if the angle is small, that cosine is almost 1. That's one approximation. The problem is, in the phase, you have to be more careful. Why do you think the phase term is more sensitive? Let's think about that. So 1 over r is the amplitude term. It tells you how it decays, 1 over r, right? So if I am at 1 over z and then z plus delta z, nothing much happens to your 1 over r. If you are 1 over 1 kilometer plus 1 meter, right, there isn't a lot of difference. But why do you think the phase term is a lot more sensitive? It's because all you need to have a complete change in phase is 2 pi. Okay? So it means that if this is my field right here, or if you want the spherical wave that I started with, and I'm looking at distance z, if there is a delay between the point here at particular elevation r, so this will be x coordinate if you want, x and z, right? So we can call this x. If this distance, I don't know, delta l, is enough to give you one wavelength, if it's the order of wavelength, you already missed 2 pi. You have the maximum error you can have in phase. You see? Because the phase only kind of goes to 2 pi and then wraps around, right? 2 pi wraps 2 pi. So it takes very little to have a huge error in phase. While the difference in amplitude, for example, if I assume, if I'm looking at z minus delta l, the amplitude is basically the same. Because 1 over z and 1 over z minus delta l will be pretty much the same if z is big. Okay? But this curvature could be enough to give you a phase error that is significant. And in microscopy, it turns out that these phase errors make all the difference. So we're going to learn how this Fresnel approximation quantifies, for example, the level of defocus in your system as a first thing. But then it quantifies pretty much all the aberrations in your system, too. You can write it down according to this approximation. Okay. So, it means that in this exponent, I need to be more careful. So, I'm going to approximate it as 1 over z, but then in the exponent, what I'm going to do is, since this is kx squared plus ky squared plus kz squared, Come on. Am I pushing anything now? There we go. I'm going to expand r, not k. Sorry about that. So let's call that k naught. So that's a constant. This is just omega over c or 2 pi over lambda, right? So that's a kind of a constant. So that's k naught square root of x squared plus y squared plus z squared. And I'm going to factor out. Let me look just at the exponent. This is approximately k naught. I'm going to factor out z, and I'm going to have 1 plus x squared plus y squared over z squared. So actually, that's no approximation yet. So that's identically equal. I just factored the z out of the square root. So we don't like square roots, OK? That's basically the idea, because they don't Fourier transform nicely. OK, so this, but now if I know z is very big compared to x and y, meaning the distance on axis is much bigger than that shift around the z-axis, right? Meaning the angles are small. That's what it means. So this angle from the source is small. Then now I can do my approximation, and I call this x, and I do a Taylor expansion on the square root. So that becomes k naught z. And then this becomes 1, approximately 1 plus x squared plus y squared over 2z squared. Right? Square root of 1 plus x is 1 of.
Is it minus?
It must be plus, right? Should be 2, yeah. Yeah, OK. So now, basically, we linearize. There is no more square root. We took the first order expansion of the square root. OK? So look at what we've done, actually. If you plug this into my original spherical wave, I end up with this formula. What is the shape of this wave front? That's a surface, right? X and Y surface. So let's say this is my optical axis. And I approximate my sphere, which was a perfect sphere on the source, to something that is no longer a sphere. What is it? What is this?
Parabolic.
Parabolic. We took a sphere and we approximated it with a parabola. So this is my sphere. And then we said, well, if the angles are very small around here, they're basically equal, see? This is something to do with your parabolic antennas that you get for radio waves, for your TVs, right? You always, for best reception, you're trying to match that wavefront that comes to your antenna. Good, but also, in terms of x and y, this looks like a, what kind of a function? I can put a minus here if that makes it more obvious, but it is some kind of a Gaussian, except it has an I here. But it turns out, actually, the Fourier transform of that Gaussian converts into the same Gaussian with the I switching from top to bottom, according to the scaling theorem. Yeah. So that's nice. Basically, that's what we wanted. Whenever we can, we make things look like a Gaussian. That's what we do pretty much many times. And the reason is very simple, because we know how to take Fourier transforms of the Gaussian. OK, but so once you know the approximations involved, so in this case, this is an approximation that takes into account that we'll be looking farther away from the source. The angles of diffraction are small. This is perfectly fine. OK, so what do we do with this? Well, Let's calculate the field far away from this source. So let's continue with our business. So we had, remember, a convolution between my input field. So I had a field or a source here, and I'm trying to compute what the field would look like a z distance away. Now I'm doing my convolution with respect to x and y. My z doesn't quite matter. It's kind of in front here. So it's kind of, notice, it's adding an attenuation according to 1 over z, the way we discussed. And also, it's adding a k naught z phase. What is that? What's the meaning of that? What is e to the I k naught z? What's that function called? A phase shift, but what is this? If this was a wave, what would? Plane wave. Okay, so what it means is that I can decompose my spherical wave into a plane wave and then kind of perturbations to that plane wave, right? So it's exactly this picture here, if you want. So I can say this is a plane wave. And then with respect to that plane wave, I have the x and y dependence. Yeah? So meaning, after, if I look at the light a kilometer away from the source, of course there will be a phase shift that takes that into account, the phase shift of a plane wave that propagated a kilometer. And then on top of, and but that's not very interesting, right? Because with respect to x and y, it's flat. So the interesting part is actually what happens here. So for your microscope, for an imaging system, the important thing is not how many pi's I have from my sample to the CCD. Nobody cares about that. It's how that phase shift and the amplitude changes with respect to x and y in my image, in my field of view. And that's exactly that. Are we okay with this? Yeah? So something I didn't mention, notice. DC to the I something x squared plus y squared has 2z at the bottom. So what does that mean? What's the z at the bottom of that Gaussian tell you? The width, which increases with z. So now you can think of this being my sample plane, if you want, and I'm trying to propagate the field at the distance z. So this could be a very specific problem. How does my image look like if I put it out of focus by a distance z? Right? So clearly this tells you that the larger the z, the worse it's going to get. Your Gaussian gets fatter and fatter. The image is going to be blurrier and blurrier. And this applies to any imaging system, to your iPhone, to anything. SLR camera, right? The larger the z distance, the blurrier the image. Your convolution is going to be between your ideal image, your crisp image, with the Gaussian that gets fatter and fatter. Make sense? You don't seem convinced. Is that okay? Okay. Still not enthusiastic about it. Okay. So this is my symbol for convolution, remember? We sometimes call this the Fresnel kernel or wavelet. Okay? Okay. So that's pretty much, you leave it there. That's the Fresnel approximation, okay? You understand what it does. It's this Gaussian phase term that gets fatter with distance z. It's going to make your image smoother and smoother as you propagate, or whatever input you have here. Yeah? But that's pretty much where you can leave it. It's a convolution. If you take it in the frequency domain, it's going to become a product. So maybe we can write that down. But there isn't much else you can do with it. So you can say u1 of k perpendicular and z, so I'm taking the Fourier transform with respect to x and y, equals u, my input of k perpendicular and z, times the Fourier transform of that Fresnel kernel. which is e to the I k naught x squared plus y squared over 2z. Okay? And do you know what this might be? So is my input as a function of k perpendicular. Okay, this should be vector, actually. So it's kx, ky. What is the Fourier transform of this thing? We worked so hard to do that approximation. Now let's use it. So that stays a Gaussian. So it's going to be something kx squared plus ky squared, or since I call it k perpendicular squared, I can just write that, k perpendicular squared. I have the 2, which I like, and I know for Gaussians, the 2 stays there. Z goes up. Z goes up. Where should I put it? Maybe here. And this thing should go down with the k naught together. And the I equals, so all together is going to give you your input of z times, I want to put my I back up. Oh, this will be e to the I, e to the whole thing, right? So I put the I up, so it's going to be minus I k perpendicular squared z over 2 k naught. So you appreciate how beautiful this is compared to that ugly convolution, right? So always easier to do a product than to do an integral, no? So this is it. You plug in whatever z distance you want, plug in whatever input field you have. This is how it's going to look like at the distance z from the input. Very easy. So notice, when you take the Fourier transform of the Gaussian of this phase term here, the sign will change from one domain to the other just because the I goes at the bottom. So it goes back and forth. This is it. We can check the units are okay. So k perpendicular times z, that gives you radians, unitless, and then k with k, we're good. All right. So, but that's pretty much all we can do with this, with the Fresnel approximation. You can take a picture in MATLAB, or two pictures. You have a picture here, has an amplitude, picture of the same size as phase, making MATLAB amplitude e to the I phase. Two matrices, and then you can play with it and propagate it over various distances, see what happens. See how your images get blurrier. And the more interesting part is to go, let's say this is my in-focus image, this is autofocus. The more interesting part is take the autofocus image and propagate it back and put it in focus. That's even more useful. Kind of one is a direct problem, one is the inverse. So once you know this thing, then clearly you can say, if you only have access to U1, to the autofocus, let's call this autofocus, then the infocus will be U of K perpendicular, and Z equals that U1 of K perpendicular and Z, times what? The complex conjugate of that thing. So e to the plus I K perpendicular squared Z over 2 K naught. So basically, we divided in the frequency domain. This amounts to what? A deconvolution. We essentially undid, is that a word? We undid.
Yeah, that's a word. It's a word?
Okay, I know undone is a word. We have undone the convolution operation. Isn't that cool? So, in principle, you can take a blurry image and numerically make it crisp, if you know that this applies. All right? Good. Now, keep in mind, the Fresnel approximation is basically convolving your field with a Gaussian as opposed to a spherical wave, and makes things much easier. And Fresnel was the first one to put the math onto the Huygens principle, right? So this is like almost 200 years before Fresnel that Huygens came up with this idea that you have secondary point sources. So you have a source that emits waves of some sort, could be waves on the pond, surface of the pond and so on. And then the points farther away from the source become secondary sources, and those themselves emit other waves. And eventually, far away from the source, what you get is a superposition of all those fields. That is precisely what this integral is telling you. This original integral, or the approximated one, whichever. That this is exactly the math for the Huygens principle. Right? So I have a point source that emits waves like this, as spherical waves. Except I have a bunch of them because my source is broad in 3D. And the wave at a certain distance from that source is simply adding all those point sources together, which is exactly what this integral does. So sometimes you may hear the Fresnel, the Huygens-Fresnel principle. So it's the Huygens idea, the great insight. Think about it, 17th century, somebody thought of this, but couldn't write the math. And then Fresnel put the math on the whole thing and make it all kind of work, just because he, in a way, contradicted Newton on the wave nature of light. Because Newton's belief kind of slowed down the learning for a little bit, for a while. Okay, so remember the story with the when nobody believed him that the light was a wave, because that would show a bright spot behind a dark obstacle, and that was counterintuitive. But there is one more approximation that we can do, meaning if we pull the observation plane even farther from the source, that's when things are getting really nice and easy. And many times we encounter this, the conditions for this approximation in the lab. So if I look at that quadratic term in the convolution, in the Fresnel convolution, they look like this, x minus u, y minus probably v. There we go. So if we make the following approximation, we are basically neglecting the quadratic terms, which is in line with the same approximation we did earlier. We now are saying that the angles are even smaller than before, such that x over z and y over z are really tiny, right? So this kind of angle is very small. So this x over z is very small, unlike what the picture suggests. If we do that, we throw away the quadratic terms, we look only at the linear terms, right? If we expand this parenthesis, then something beautiful happens. The integral that used to look like this now will look like this. I already changed the variables here to suggest that actually this is nothing more but a Fourier transform. Okay? So by dropping the quadratic terms in x and y, we end up with the linear term in u, v, x, and y. And all those proportionality constants up here, like k naught, which is 2 pi over lambda, and the z, I can call those kx. some kind of spatial frequency, so that this looks exactly like a Fourier transform. What does this all mean? What it means is the following, that if I have an input field here at the origin, and I'm looking far, far away, so this is called a Fraunhofer approximation, so beyond the distance for Fresnel, even farther than Fresnel. What I get at that particular plane, far away from the source, is nothing more but the Fourier transform of my input field. What's the meaning of that? Let's look at the spatial frequencies. So, you compute the Fourier transform, which we like. It's instantaneous. If you have it, you have a MATLAB, you get the result essentially in no time. But the result will be in the spatial frequency domain. To actually understand how the field is distributed across this plane here in terms of actual spatial units, x and y, you plug in the spatial frequency as 2 pi x over lambda z. Meaning, let's look at what that means. So, kx is 2 pi over lambda. This is the k naught that we had in the exponent, right? X over z, what is x over z? Is this over z is basically approximately theta for small angles, or tangent of theta, which we approximate as theta, is theta. So it's 2 pi over lambda, basically theta. What does that mean? It means that your spatial frequency is basically proportional to the angle. So I'm at the plane of input. This is the, I don't know, could be your image, could be any, really any input field. I'm looking far away. Spatial frequency, high spatial frequency of this field will correspond to large angles. And you see how it all makes sense, because if I want to, for example, image with high detail, with high resolution, a certain object, meaning I want to collect high frequencies from this object, I better collect large angles from that object. That's fundamentally where the resolution limitation comes in, into a microscope. That's why we're bringing that objective close to the sample, so we collect these large angles. We're going to look in a moment at what lenses do. The lenses do a very similar thing. That's what allows the imaging systems to work so beautifully. Okay, so the higher the angle, the higher the spatial frequencies. And there is also a wavelength involved. So the smaller the angle, the higher the spatial frequency. So if your business is, like we're all microscopists, and our goal in life is to image with the highest possible resolution, what does this tell you? The first one told need high angles. Okay, so high resolution means high angle, high theta. We need to collect large angles from the sample. How about the wavelength? Short. Very simple. Comes right out. So that explains why when you go from the old CD-ROM to a DVD, people change the wavelength. You need to, if you want to pack more tracks on that disk, right, there is a physical limit. We'll quantify what that limit is in a moment, but there's a physical limit to how tightly you can focus that light, and it's really related to this. And at some point, if you maximize the angles, the only thing left to change is the wavelength. So we went from near-infrared light on CD-ROM, red light on DVD, and then we got Blu-ray. And then we stopped, because really, who's using DVDs nowadays? We went straight to streaming, which is something Streaming doesn't come out from really from a real cloud, comes out from a hard disk somewhere. And now how is the hard disk written? That has some features too. Much smaller than our CD-ROMs, that's why we can pack so much information in a smaller space. How is the hard disk written? Huh? Okay, that's the mechanism, the memory mechanism, but at some point there is some photolithography that goes on, no? How is the chip on your cell phone written? Excimer. Yeah, excimer laser, meaning the wavelength is pushed all the way to deep UV. I mean, kind of deep. Could be deeper, but. So shorter wavelengths, UV, way outside, way far away from the blue, which is around 400 nanometers. So excimer laser is, don't remember, 40? No. Cannot be. Maybe 180. You Google it. But it's UV. And if you go farther, you get X-rays, right? Shorter wavelengths, and gamma rays, even shorter wavelengths. And you see, it makes sense that actually the gamma rays report on the structure of the nucleus, right? Which is way below the size of the atom, right? Molecules. So it makes sense that if you look at smaller and smaller things, the wavelength of that should be shorter and shorter. That's the way it is. That's why visible light reports essentially on atomic or molecular electronic transitions. Keep that in mind. So there are vibration and there are rotations, right? Are the modes of transition. Okay, so we can learn a lot just by looking at this simple equation, that spatial frequency is basically proportional to angle, inversely proportional to wavelength. And there isn't a lot of room that we have. You either increase the theta or decrease the wavelength if you want higher resolution. There isn't much else we can do. What's another way to reduce the wavelength? So of course I can change my source, go to UV, X-ray, whatever. The reason we don't have X-ray microscopes that work very well is actually problems with the sources and the optics, because we don't really have good lenses for X-rays. They have to be all mirrors of some sort, and they have to be at very shallow angles, so there are complications. How about the electron microscopy, by the way? We haven't talked about that. The Broglie wavelength associated with electrons is even shorter than X-rays. Right? So we should be able to see structures inside each atom with the electron microscope. Easily. You use magnets as lenses, exactly. So the electrons are charged. There's no more glass that will focus your electron beam. You have to use these lenses. The problem with those magnetic lenses is that they introduce a lot of aberration. And it's a very sad, sad thing that the only reason we don't see things clearly at the atomic level, even though the wavelength is much shorter than the atomic size with the electrons, is because of aberrations, not because of physics. I mean, still, everything is physics, but not because of a fundamental limit. It's because our lenses are terrible. Okay, so I was asking you one last question. How can I make my wavelength shorter without changing the source? Change refractive index. So now you understand why there is immersion objectives. You put a drop of liquid between your lens and the sample, and the wavelength in that medium becomes lambda over n. And actually, more recently, so this is called immersion. I think I already mentioned maybe briefly to you that there was a research paper less than 10 years ago, I don't know, maybe 6, 7, talking about solid immersion. Solid immersion. So you make a lens with a high refractive index and you bring that very close to the sample. So it's as if you're immersing the sample in a medium of high refractive index, or you're imaging with a wavelength that actually comes of that solid material. So it could be lambda over 4. Yeah.
Does it make sense to a burst or a condenser as well to get higher frequencies?
Nope. That would high frequency in the illumination. Yes. Yes. So that, let's talk about that when we get to the condenser. So there's a boost in resolution when you illuminate the light. We'll talk about that later, okay, but just a preview. If you illuminate with a plane wave versus illuminating with a bunch of plane waves, makes a difference in terms of the resolution. It's actually better to illuminate with the collection of wavelengths. Like, for example, in confocal, you focus down the beam, okay? Or you illuminate to incoherent or diffuse light. You get the same boost in resolution with respect to a plane wave illumination. We'll talk about that. So actually, they sell both immersion objectives and condensers. So you can actually boost the angles that you illuminate with by adding an immersion on the condenser side, on that lens that focuses the illumination down. We'll talk about that. Don't worry. OK, so a lot we can learn from this simple equation. Most importantly, what this tells us is that you are able now to solve pretty much any diffraction problem that you can think of. In particular, imagine I have a plane wave illuminating an aperture. Any aperture, the beautiful thing is. Could be square, could be circle, could be star. I don't know how to draw it, okay? Anything. And if somebody's asking you, like, for example, the next homework, how does the field look like a distance z away from that plane, given this aperture? Boom. You do a Fourier transform of this, so square. It's going to look like sync. Instantaneous result. I'm going to predict immediately it's going to look like this. And then you convert the sync in the k domain to x by doing this substitution. And then you are going to be able to tell how much is the field amplitude m phase at each position with respect to x. Like very fast. So quickly, since we're here. We talked about this, but now let's put it in the context. Now you see all my examples with the k vectors and stuff. Why? Please. What if I have two apertures? How is this going to diffract light? I want you to go back and use a property that we hammered over and over again. Shift. So since I know that the field at this plane at Fraunhofer distance away is a Fourier transform of this input, and let's say these are two rectangles, yeah? So what does the shift theorem tell me? Fringe. I think I know what you mean, but can you make it more scientific? So it's as if I'm only doing diffraction through one slit. Remember? So it's as if I have diffraction from only one slit. So again, I'm plotting the intensity here. So it's going to be maximum in the middle, oscillations like that. And because I have two of these, there will be some kind of oscillations in the middle. And the oscillations are higher and higher frequencies as the distance of the shifts. It's larger, right? The inverse. So notice, this is the Young interferometer, but now with the generic aperture. Before, I think I mentioned to you, if I have two delta functions, it gives you a perfect cosine, meaning this envelope will be flat. This is a generalization of that. What if my apertures have a finite size? Well, I still get my cosine from the shift, which is what you meant by fringe, I assume. But now the envelope relates to the size of this, okay? So the overall envelope of the signal corresponds to the smallest structure in this domain, and vice versa. The smallest structure here corresponds to the largest structure in the object domain, which is nothing more but this distance. Yeah? So clearly, as I make my aperture bigger and bigger, what happens to my diffraction pattern? I must have some picture somewhere here, maybe later. Okay, so according to this Fourier transform, relationship between the diffracted light versus the input light, input field. If I pass it through an aperture and now I increase the aperture size, how is the diffracted field changing? Because narrow. I'm closing the aperture, the diffracted field gets fatter. I'm closing the aperture beyond the wavelength, then what happens? If I make an aperture so small that it's smaller than the wavelength, it won't propagate. Unless in some very special situations like plasmons and things like that. So this is the same reason your door of the microwave works. Remember that, right? That the holes are big enough so we see through them, so much bigger than the wavelength of light. But they're much smaller than the wavelength of the microwave. So it's that principle. Okay, so as you close this down, basically, this frequency required to solve an aperture that is, let's say, lambda over 10, will exceed 2 pi over lambda. That's kind of the physics. So it wouldn't work. Okay. So basically, we understand everything about far field propagation. What we need to understand now is what lenses do to your field, to your light. And once we understand that, then we are just going to put the two together. Right? So if I know how the vacuum propagates and I know how the lenses transform my field, all I need to do is to put them all together and make microscopes, telescopes, pretty much anything, cameras. So let's do that. It's actually a beautiful thing what's going to happen, that the lens is doing something very similar to the vacuum, except on a much tighter space. So how do we start with this? First of all, this is my lens. It's made of a piece of glass that was polished to, say, spherical surfaces of different radii, R1 and R2. They could be of other shapes, but let's not worry about that now. Okay? So first question is, and you know historically, this was a big business. Lens makers were, I think, a very respectable job back, I don't know, since the Dark Ages. First glasses were reported in the 1200s, I think. And they were making, some of these applications were really funny. You wouldn't probably have thought about the fact that one big application was to check textile manufacturing. So there are people paid to actually get these lenses, probably of not very high quality, but still, they were polished manually to some kind of a spherical shape. And then there are people who are actually sliding these up and down on your textile that were made by some other people, and they will point to defects at the small scale in the fabric. So that was a big business. So that's precursor to microscopy. Okay, so that's before 1600s. And then people realized that actually, if you combine two lenses, some magic happens. You start to really see small things. Okay, so people know how to polish this glass for a long time. Oh, another application was to take one good lens and check on other lenses, on new lenses. So one of the words that made it to microscopy is Schlerin, which is a word for German for imperfections in a glass, so that kind of cracks, small. Anybody German in the room? So nobody can proof check me. So there are sometimes during fabrication, there are cracks and maybe bubbles and things like that. So you would use a good lens to check on the new lenses. Okay, so there is such a thing as Schlerin microscopy. We're going to talk about that. Okay, so here's my lens, piece of block, two surfaces. And I want to understand how my phase changes. If I put a plane wave here, how is that going to look like on the other side of the lens? So we know automatically what's going to happen. But here's the physics, and I'm going to let you do the proof of this later. So this is a flat wavefront coming in. What happens on axis is that you see this light goes through the thickest part of the lens, right? And because the speed of light in glass is C over N, this part is going to be slow than, say, this glass. Than this ray, for example. So as I move farther and farther away from the axis, I'm going to get less glass and more air. So we're comparing what happens in between these two planes. So on axis, it's all glass. As I move up, I'm going to get more and more air, less and less glass. So clearly, the outer rays are going to go faster. So if I were to plot my wavefront, which is the trajectory, the surface of all the points in phase, what I'm going to get is a curved surface, suggesting that this moves faster than this one. And of course, that's the way it should be, because when you have a curved surface like this, essentially, it looks as if you want in time reverse, think of this in time reverse, it's as if I have the focal point here, and it's emitting light backwards. You see it? So that's the physics. That's the reason why the lenses focus the light down to a point. Because the light on the outer regions here, far from the center, from the optical axis, they move faster. So they curve, they take this plane wave and they curve it, and all the light converges here. And I always encourage the students to think in time reverse whenever possible. Light is great for that kind of thing. You can go back and forth in time. So you see, maybe it was counterintuitive that this will focus to a point if you have curved wavefronts like that. But if I told you I have a point source here, you will immediately be able to tell me that that's a spherical wave that goes out, right? And then after that point, what's going to happen? Well, now it's going to look like emission, right? So focus down and emits down. Okay, so skipping over the details of this little geometry problem, what you get as for this wavefront is a constant, which is, again, it's a plane wave that is common to all the points, so we don't really care about that. And the interesting part is here. You get R squared, which is what? Right there, it tells you that this surface looks like a parabola again. N minus 1, so notice we're in air, refractive index 1, the lens has refractive index N. Meaning, if the refractive index of the lens is 1, nothing happens. Okay, that makes sense. And then 1 of R1 minus 1 of R2. By the way, it's very interesting. You can have two different media. As long as they have the same refractive index, obviously the light doesn't care. So you see, you can do these experiments for kids where you put a glass rod in oil that has the same refractive index, and the glass rod disappears. Okay? So it's no problem. You have two different materials, same refractive index. The light doesn't see it. It becomes invisible. And by the way, that has applications in biology. If you want to penetrate deeper with the light, deeper image, deeper in the tissue, to reduce multiple scattering, which is what kind of limits our depth, some people are index matching the tissue. So you add some kind of liquid that actually reduces this refractive index contrast. We're going to talk more about that when we deal with scattering later. Okay, by definition, this thing is called the convergence of the lens. C, which is the inverse of the focal distance. That is the definition of a focal distance. N minus 1, 1 of R1 minus 1 of R2. So basically it says that if I want a very strong convergence, like the objective of a microscope, you should make your refractive index very high. So that requires a very, so to get a strong convergence means the focal distance is very short. So that requires very high refractive index contrast. So make it of a material that's actually very high refractive index. There isn't a lot of option there because you also want this to be transparent. Okay, so you can get semiconductors with very high refractive index and you lose all your light. Try to pass light through them, so that's kind of defeating the purpose. Okay, and then very high curvature on the lens. And that's where problems begin, because high curvature means your small angle approximation doesn't quite work. It means you have geometric aberrations that are coming in. So that's why when we buy an objective, the money goes to having it both ways a little bit. So very high, very strong magnification, very strong power, short focal distances, high curvatures, and at the same time, they are aberration corrected to some extent. The more money you pay, the more corrected they are. So in fact, the objectives are not single lenses. There's a bunch of lenses in there that are actually combined together to minimize the aberrations. Okay? So these aberrations come from the very strong curvatures that are necessary for high magnification. Okay, so you notice this looks like a parabola in the same way the propagation in free space was. But now what happens if I propagate the field, let's say my input field is here, I'm propagating with the Fresnel propagation that I learned earlier to the surface of the lens, then I pass that field through the lens, boop, on the other side, and then I propagate again to a distance d2. And I want to know how that field looks like. Can we do that? Formally, it's very easy. Meaning symbolically, all I need to do is to, this is my input U1. U2 over here will be U1 convolved with the Fresnel kernel. You see it? This one right here, D1 is the distance. My Z becomes D1. Yeah? But now, I need to take the field U2, incident on the lens, multiply it with that Gaussian due to the lens, which is this. Take that field U3, and then to figure out the U4 at the distance D2, I need to take that and convolve that with another Fresnel propagator, but now the distance is D2. So basically, symbolically, I was able to write it very quickly. To do it in practice, to compute this by hand at least, is a little bit of a mess. Can be done, but there is something beautiful that happens when D1 and D2 are such that they're equal to F. Meaning, if I have my input field right the focal distance in front of the lens, and my observation plane is a focal distance behind the lens, a bunch of these quadratic terms cancel out, and look what I'm getting. I get that U4, so I'm talking about the field here now, the relationship between the input here and the output here is a simple Fourier transform. So U4 is the Fourier transform of the input, right? Where the spatial frequencies look exactly like those for the free space, except now the distance is the focal distance. It's not Z, but it's F. Somehow I was expecting a round of applause at this result. It's very powerful. Why is it so powerful? Well, it's powerful that the diffraction equation also ends up in a Fourier transform. But this is even more useful because in the Fraunhofer approximation with diffraction free space, we have to be far away from the source. So it's a pretty strong approximation for the angles to be very tiny. This actually The lens is doing a Fourier transform on actually very confined spaces, from F to F. Lens in the middle, F, F. I get my Fourier transform like that. I don't need to get out of the lab to go a kilometer away. Okay, so for one thing, I can do Fourier transforms at the speed of light, which is kind of cool. So I can have any field here. Again, I can put any apertures that I want at the input focal plane. And I look on the other side, I get their Fourier transform just like that. I can put transparencies with pictures on them. I will get the Fourier transform of that, whatever they are. A lot of combinations that I can do. But, and the physics, notice, the physics is the same. X over F and Y over F is nothing more but angle. So let's see how that looks like. Imagine I have my input field, a sinusoid. Perfect sinusoid. Well, with a DC term, let's say it's actually a grating. Okay? I can never make a transmission that goes negative, so I always have a DC term on the grating, right? So it's 1 plus cosine. So basically, I really have a transmission that goes sinusoidally with respect to x. So at the output, I'm going to take the Fourier transform of this whole thing. What's the Fourier transform of 1? Delta function. It's going to be delta function at the origin, meaning this DC, this light that goes on axis out of the grating, which is a plane wave, is going to be focused right at the origin in the focal plane, right at the origin of the frequencies. Basically, that's the delta we're talking about. Delta at the origin at zero frequencies, focused to one point. But now, the Fourier transform of the cosine gives me two delta functions. What do the two delta functions correspond to? Well, they correspond to these two diffraction orders. So there will be one plane wave coming at this angle and another plane wave coming at this angle. The lens takes them all and focuses down on the same plane, focal plane, except they are shifted, one up by a certain amount, the other one down by a certain amount. And that's how the diffraction gratings work. So basically, the lens is mapping angles into points, which is consistent to my k being something like 2 pi over lambda times theta. The finer the grating, the steeper the angle, the higher the frequency, the focus point of that diffraction order will be focused farther away. That's the reason these are spatial frequencies. The higher I go corresponds to the higher frequencies of the object. Yeah? Any questions so far before we jump into microscopy? Because now everything is going to be easy with the microscopes. I know what the free space does. I know what the lenses do. All I need to do is to put them all together. Any questions? Everything crystal clear? Yeah? I don't believe you, but okay. Okay, what happens if I shift my grating? Here's a question. If you think you know everything, what happens to my field at the output if I shift the grating by a certain amount up?
Still for the transform.
Okay, but does anything happen? I didn't say I'm looking at the intensity. I'm asking what's the output field. But it's true. There is a ramp in. Where is that coming from?
It's just a Fourier transform property.
So I'm applying basically the shift theorem the other way around, right? So I'm shifting now the object, and that will give me that e to the I kx, right? On top here, which will be is going to be a certain phase ramp on top of this. So the intensity will look the same, but the phases of these will be different. Yeah? Okay. Okay. Do you know who Abe was? Yeah? Who?
I know the resolution limit is named after
it. Very good. Do you know when that came about?
When?
I
don't know.
You don't know?
Is it 1600?
1600. Well, the funny thing is, 1600 was when the microscope was invented. Slightly before 1600. But it took us until 1873 to come up with an equation for it, for the resolution. That's how slow we're moving. Okay, so there was a microscope, and then for 273 years, or 280 years, people didn't quite know exactly what the resolution limit was. It didn't have an understanding of how to put the microscope in equations. And the first theory was by Abbe in 1873, writing a famous formula that we're going to see in a second. And his equation, I took a picture with that monument, is written in stone in Jena, in Germany, because that kind of governed the microscopies for more than a century, until recently when new scientists found a way around it, the resolution limit. Okay, so the reason this happened in 1873 is because Maxwell's equations happened a little bit before. So we celebrated 150 years last year. So is it 1869? No. There we go. This was Maxwell's treatise on basically explaining electromagnetism by putting all the observations together from electrostatics and Hertz's discoveries of electromagnetic waves. And he was able to write these equations that kind of put everything together. And maybe you know that actually you can find this treatise on Google for free. It's kind of nice to. And what you're going to find out is that it wasn't a nice set of four equations that we know today. It was actually a set of a bunch of them. I think maybe 10, 12, I don't remember. And it took, another mathematician to kind of reduce them to the equations we know today. But still, Maxwell's equations, one of the greatest kind of achievements in science. And that's what enabled then Lord Rayleigh, probably you heard of him, Rayleigh scattering. Based on Maxwell's equations, he was able to tell how scattering by small particles happened. He was able to explain why the sky was blue, things like that, which we didn't know back then, 1870s. And we're going to learn Rayleigh scattering too in the scattering chapter. Okay, so very interesting. There is an instrument that operated for almost 300 years without the governing equation that described, you know, its capabilities. How do we describe the microscope now? In the simplest way possible that I know is to take a lens, place a sample in its front focal plane, place a second lens with the focal plane in the back focal plane of the first one. Okay, so this is a common focal plane. And then look what happened at the output of this second lens. So microscopists are known for putting names on all kinds of nomenclature on the thing. So we call this an objective. We call this a tube lens. but they're just lenses. Okay? So, with what we just learned, the most kind of physically meaningful way to describe the microscope is to think of the field right here being the Fourier transform of the sample field, and then have the second lens do another Fourier transform of this field, right? Because I know from here to here I have a Fourier transform, and from here to here I have another one. And what's a Fourier transform of a Fourier transform? Because this is not Fourier transform inverse, I take two forward Fourier transforms, I still get my function back, but it's flipped. So what it means is that if my object was upside down, or up, what's the opposite of upside down? Upside up.
Right side up, okay.
Okay, so if this is right side up, you get it upside down. But of course, when we look at cells, who's there to tell where the head and feet are? So clearly, that comes out right from here. So what is the magnification? If you look at the Fourier transform for each lens, you have an F that factors into those Ks, right? So remember, the Kx, Ky are actually 2 power over lambda, right? X over F. So that tells you, that F tells you how the spatial frequency scales up or down. When you combine the two and you do the calculation, you do this Fourier transform over Fourier transform, if you change a variable, you are going to end up with the fact that your function, meaning your object field, is going to be inverted, so minus X minus Y, but also scaled by a certain number, M. And that M is basically the ratio between these two focal distances. So what is M? It's nothing more but the magnification. So what it says is that I start with a function F of X and Y, so the field of, I don't know, across my cell. And what I get at the CCD plane, I get the exact same thing, flipped, but who cares, and then scaled up. If this ratio is greater than 1, or scaled down if the ratio is smaller than 1. Yeah? So, by the way, that's the difference between a telescope and a microscope. This is a telescopic system. Whenever you match the focal planes of one, back focal plane of one with the front focal plane of the other, that's called a telescope. But obviously, this will not be very good to look at the stars, because what you want to do with the telescope is to demagnify the stars, to get them from their humongous size to actually fit on your camera. So your magnification is actually very, very tiny. 10 to minus, I don't know, orders of magnitude, right? So a microscope, you have to turn it upside down to turn it into a telescope to be useful, right? So you want the stars to look from here. From here. OK, so in one case, we want to demagnify big objects so they fit onto our retina. In the microscope case, you want to blow those little cells up so you can see them. OK? So now you see how you can describe it very quickly without even ray tracing. You should know how to ray trace stuff, at least these two kind of particular type of rays. So this is what we do in 460 in the fall with the undergrad course. But OK, so you should know that if I take a ray parallel to the optical axis, the lens, what's going to do is to bend it and send it to the focal plane on axis. OK, that's basically, in our language now, that is basically the DC that gets focused at the zero, at the origin of the frequency domain. OK? And then if I take another ray that starts at the origin of the sample, at this particular angle, what's going to happen is that it's going to become parallel to the optical axis. How do we understand that in terms of our Fourier stuff? Well, one way to think of it is to think of it backwards. So if I have the light coming this way parallel, it's going to be focused in the back focal plane, right? That's the reason. So notice, if you know these two rays, then you are able to make to draw any image through any optical system. So this is my object. All I need to do is to find out this point propagating through my lens. I take one ray and then I take, let's say, this other ray. If I take the ray through the center of the lens, it turns out it stays undeviated. Where these points meet, that's where the image is formed. This is y prime. So this is the type of ray tracing that helps in geometrical optics to figure out the positions of your image. Why is this ray going through the center? Notice, can this be in the focal plane of the lens? According to my picture, I have an image through one lens that is focused at this particular distance. Where is my object placed? Can it be in the focal plane of this?
No.
Why?
Because those two rays will never converge.
Will never converge. If I put my object at the focal plane right here, the image will be formed at infinity. Okay? So most likely it's a little bit shifted to the left. Okay? So with these two kinds of rays, you can propagate through many lenses and figure out where the image is going to be formed. That's geometrical optics. We deal here with wave optics and free optics, which they should kind of agree, right? So finally, I mean, not finally, but the next question is, so we know what the magnification is. In this case, is the ratio of these two. We know kind of what happens with my field. It's two Fourier transforms. That's what makes my image. Question is, can I make this M infinite? Can I make it a million? Can I add another set of lenses? So if this is my image plane here, imagine I add another system like that, a replica of it. So this, let's say this object here is going to be magnified this big at the image plane. And then I take another one and so on and so on. So I take this little piece and it's going to be this big. What will be the final magnification? If this has M1 from here to here, this has M2 from here to here, what will be the total M? Do you know?
Multiplying.
So it's going to be M1 times M2. Okay? So this will be Y2 over Y0, which will be Y1 over Y0 times Y2 over Y1. So this is M1, this is M2. So right there, it means that if I cascade this 1,000 times, and each magnification, let's say, is 100, and I go crazy, I buy 1,000 microscopes, from the Gates Foundation, nobody's going to give you money for 1,000 microscopes, but let's say I do that. Would I be able to see molecules?
In theory, yes.
In theory, yes. Okay. What do you mean, in theory?
Assuming you can image rays down to an infinitely small point, you can definitely do it.
I don't know what I mean. So what? Provided I can image rays?
Assuming your metric optics is correct and you can image rays down to a single point, then yeah.
Okay, so let me ask you the other way. Is that, does that happen? Why not?
Because of diffraction.
Because of diffraction. And now we are going to translate what that diffraction means in terms of our Fourier transform properties, because there is that scaling between the Fourier transforms. So how do we put the two together? The fact that physically, yes, I can make a magnification system of a million. I can have magnification of a million. No problem with that. Except it's going to be completely useless. It's exactly like trying to scan this page with your cell phone and then going and zooming in it a million times. So the information is basically fixed by the scanning. It's a priori fixed in a way. So you digitally zooming in it, at some point you are going to make a pixel this big and you are going to zoom into that pixel a million times. That will be completely useless. That's why we don't do it. What's the equivalent of my pixel? It's basically the diffraction spot, the smallest feature, the smallest frequency that I can recover. It's as if the field passing through my microscope is already kind of smooth over areas of the order of lambda square. So it makes no sense to magnify that lambda square 1,000 times because you're going to get the flat image. There'll be no features whatsoever, right? It's as if that diffraction spot is your pixel. So magnification of a million, no problem. Do you gain anything? No, after a while, there's no point in doing that because the physics is what limits our resolution. Okay, and by the way, getting a camera with 100 million pixels, that doesn't help either. And there's some confusion sometimes in the literature because in computer science, what they call resolution is pixels. So sometimes there are algorithms that blow your pixels into 4 pixels and you take those and you blow them into smaller and smaller pixels. We're not talking about that. We're talking about the physics that actually smooths out my field over something of the order of lambda square, which we are going to actually define next time. And it's something to do with the fact that my spatial frequencies are finite. Meaning this Fourier plane of my image right here is finite. And since I have a frequency coverage that is finite in the spatial domain, the best I can do is 1/that width in terms of spatial resolution. Okay? So it's simply because this is finite in space. Or another way of saying is that if I increase the spatial frequency of this grating in the earlier example, they're going to start shooting past my lens. As trivial as that. As far as the lens is concerned, this light doesn't exist. It's not, this imaging system, whatever it is not going to see frequencies, sinusoids that are this small. That's where the blurriness is coming from. Okay.